Today is a special day, it's the yahrzeit for my great-grandfather, Rabbi Elimelech Lipman Weisblum from Lizhensk. My son, our oldest son, Elimelech, named after him. Here is part of the famous prayer we have at the very beginning, on the morning prayer. Adraba, he wrote, furthermore, ten belibeinu, Almighty God, please put in our heart shenir'e kol echad ma'alat chavereinu velo chesronam. Put in our hearts, my great-grandfather wrote to his followers, that we should always look at other people's good part, to try to judge them favorably, to think positively about other people, and not the part that they are not so good. Furthermore, he said, "V'shenedaber kol echad et chaviro," that we should speak about our fellow, "baderech hayashar v'aryatzu lefanecha," the way that we should imagine that God is there all the time and watching what we are saying. So therefore, we should talk about other people in a way that we wanted them to speak about us. Ve'al yale shum sin'a me'echad al chaviro chalila. While we are about to pray for you, to you, any manner of hatred should not enter to our mind against our fellow by any means. That's part of tefillah, kodem tefillah, prayer, before the prayer that we recite every day. Those Hasidim that follow Nusach Sfar recite every day before the morning prayer. The truth is that last night I get several phone calls and emails from people who ask me how come I'm not in Lizhensk. This is the burial site that Grandpa was buried. My first reaction is that Hashem hears the prayer everywhere, but for sure it's good for those who like and can. One of the story about him that I heard from so many people is that the beginning of the Shoah, the World War II, the Nazis desecrated many cemeteries, and the story goes that they entered to his grave and opened, and they get so scared, the SS officers, they ran away, all of them. And the story goes that they claim that they saw the formulation of the body like he just passed, while the time that he's passing is 100 years earlier. So it's kind of a special privilege, in a way, to be direct descendants, ben achar ben. Up to my father's father, they're all Hasidic rabbis. My late grandfather stopped from being Hasidic Rebbe as a result of the crisis of the Holocaust, that he miraculously was able to escape. So in a way, we are still Hasidic family, but we do not practicing the manner of the Rebbe, meaning to be a... not long ago, I went with our president to one of the renowned Hasidic Rebbe in New York, and he repeats that question, how come I'm not a Rebbe? Maybe my brother. My brother, 1 year younger than me, Rabbi Uri, he is the head of yeshiva in Beitar, and he married to the Slonim Rebbe's daughter. So he is absolute ingenious and have all the capability to be a Hasidic Rebbe one day. Anyway, I can be a good Shabbos. We are the Mishna, page 36b, some introduction before the Mishna. Number one is the subject of Tashlumei Kofer, meaning we have a situation that someone committed a murder, and the Bet Din, the rabbinic court, make a decision that they should execute him. The family for our instance, is a wealthy family, they went to the family of the murderer and they offer them $1 million in exchange of the execution. The Torah said that you cannot do that. So we're going to the details. We're going to continue the subject of Kimle Bederaba Minei, meaning when you have two penalties, everyone remember that? We have two penalties. We choose the severe penalty over the light penalty. Two examples. One, if it's execution on order against someone who committed a severe crime, and by the same token there is a monetary involved here, we basically override the monetary payment by having the person executed. The same way, if it's a dual punishment, such as a flogs, lashes, and money, this is again disputation, discussion. Can you impose both, or by having one, it's enough for the other? The last subject, times allow, we're going to deal with a subject of Egla Arufa, with the heifer, meaning if it's a body was found out of a city, and the Torah said in Deuteronomy that we need to measure, take the measure between the corpse and the closest city, and then the elder of the city needs to put a proclamation that the hands are not involved with that unknown death. Later, if the murderer was found, the question is, since we already did the ritual, should we still impose execution upon the murderer or not? So we are on page 36b of the Mishnah. Leilu Nishmat, Grandpa, Rav Elimelech, Lipman Weisblum, may his good deeds and Torah teaching be a zchut to all of us.
Amen.
Amen.
Mishnah ve'elu she'en lahem knas. So here we deal with a case very painful, that either it was an act of rape, act of seduction, and as we explained in the past, we differentiate between a minor that's below than 3 years and 1 day and past that age. In general, we say that the manner of virginity will come back, versus if she passed that age, it's different. And for our discussion, the difference is in a matter of fine, knas. If you impose the fine or not, in general, so far we say that below than 3 years and 1 day, we do impose, versus other not, because we differentiate between someone who's no longer a virgin versus the one who is. So that's called Bechezkat Be'ulot. If she is already set up in a matter of marriage, then it's a different framework of payment. Ve'elu she'en lahem knas. So these are the cases of young women who do not have fine paying to their fathers when they raped or seduced. Meaning, as we explained many times, the whole manner of protection and charge belongs to the father in that age of minority, by the biblical terms. So therefore, if she was raped, we differentiate between certain cases. So number one, we start haba al hagiyoret ve'al hashvuya ve'al hashifcha. So again, we speak here about specific cases. Each of them later we discuss, the convert, the captivity. Tosfot asks, what's the idea of captive? Tosfot said that the idea of captivity is only rabbinic, because the truth is, as we discussed earlier, the capture a person, it's not necessarily someone who have relation while she was in jail or in prison, but the sages put a special stringencies. So that's the story of the knas, that not receive a fine. But the Shita Mekubetzet said that, biblically speaking, she's considering under the category of Be'ula. Anyway, so they said, Shenivdu, Veshenitgayru, Veshenishtachru. Here you see a little different order, and we'll explain in the past why. יתרות על בנות שלוש שנים ויום אחד. As we explain, we differentiate in age between up to 3 years and 1 day and onward, just a general category. רב יהודה אומר שבויה שנבדית הרי בקדושתה אף על פי שגדולה. Meaning, if you have a captive that was released, you treated it as a virgin, even she passed the age of 3 years and 1 day. Now, the idea is, it's not necessarily that she was seduced or raped, it may be not. So if she was raped, there is a concept of knas, or fine, that the father received. Next case is haba al bito. Here, you talk about a situation, as Rashi elaborated on Tractate Sanhedrin, page 75. Someone who have relation of with a daughter of a woman that he raped in the past, which means it wasn't a matter of marriage between the man and that woman. He raped her, and later in life, he have relation with her daughter, which is, in a sense, considering his daughter. So the big question is, do you impose the kimle bederava minei or not? Which means, since you have mitat bet din, since you are under the framework of the execution followed by the rabbinic court, so you do not have the knas, you don't have the fine, as we explained many times, when you have the severe penalty, it's override the other. Next, albat bito, the daughter of his daughter, albat beno, the daughter of his son, it's all Leviticus 18. Albat ishto, so here you talk about the daughter of the wife that married to him, but this is a daughter that come out from other marriage, which in our modern language is the stepdaughter. Albat bena, the daughter of her son, albat bita, the daughter of her daughter, en laim knas, you don't have a framework of fine. Why? Mipnei shemitchayev benafsho shemitatan bitei bet din. So as we explain, that all of these six cases, they receive a punishment of sreifa, which is the execution by the bet din. And therefore, since it's already imposed the severe punishment, you do not put the bo'alei arayot, those cases, with monetary payment. וכל המתחייב בנפשו אין משלם המון. That's the idea of something that we discussed a lot in the past several days. You remember, kimlei bidraba minei. You go by the severe penalty, שנאמר, here is the source, in the book of Shmot, Exodus chapter 21. If two men have a quarrel, and they fight, and the pregnant wife of the one of the men interfere, so the Torah said, "Velo yason anoshi anesh," which means, if that pregnant woman did not pass as a result of interfering of that quarrel, so we impose upon this man a heavy monetary payment, which is he paid for the miscarriage of the baby. However, we derive from that if it was ason, if it was tragedy, which means that the woman passed as a result of that fighting, so he deserved a capital punishment because he is a murderer. So therefore, he is exempt of paying for the baby, for the fetus that passed. So the Yerushalmi asked a question. He said, since you tell me that the father, in general, we say that the father is the one, if you talk about minors, right? The father is the one who received the fine for his daughter. So remember, one of the case, we talk about someone who intercourse in most disgusting illicit matter with his daughter, right? You tell me that the father get the fine for the someone who did a matter of seduction or rape, but if you're talking about his own daughter, how do you impose that? So there is a big discussion. One of the ideas that the rabbi said, it's You talk about me'oreset shenitgarsha. Talk about a rare case that she was engaged and then she was divorced, and therefore the fine come to her, not to him. But in general term, father that involved with a rape in any manner, even a step, right? Since we have kimle bederav aminin, since we impose the death, then is nothing to discuss over money. Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Rabbi Yehuda, and Rabbi Dosa amru davar echad, which is that they, if she was a shvuya, she was a captor, she is bechezkat betula. We have the assumption that she is virgin. Rabbi Yehuda ad amaran, because we just said that we have the imposition of fine, of knas, because she is still bechezkat betula. Rabbi Dosa de Tanya. Here is a situation of a daughter of Kohen, that it's a different category, that she was shvuya, that she was captured by the enemy, or chelet bitruma. Why? Because you have the assumption that it's not lo bechrach she pasluta, it's not necessarily that they violated her. Divrei Rabbi Dosa. Amar Rabbi Dosa, v'chi amaya asa la'aravi alaz, v'chi mipnei shemi'ech la ben dadei apsala min ha'kehuna. He asked a question. He said, what it is, he used the term Arabs, but it's the idea is, what does they did that enemy or Arab, whatever they captured, was took to a captive? It's that he did all kind of inappropriate, you know, he touched her, etc., inappropriately. Is that mean that what happened here is that they do all kind of things, but they still do not have the manner of rape necessarily? So Tosfot said, why is they use the term Arab? Tosfot said, he bring a Gemara in Kiddushin 49, he said, Aser kabin zima yardu la'olam, the world received 10 measure of zima, of manner of licentious, is that correct?
Licentious, yeah.
Yes, and 9 the Arab took. So it means that they are, the mind is very much with this. That's the way Tosfot said. But in general, the idea is that Rashi here, I'm using my book, Rashi here said, "Klomar einu agin b'hem efker lo onsan bebi'ilah la leshachek imahem." Rashi said it's clear, but according to the Rabbanan, the sages, the concern is that she maybe have cohabitation. So what exactly the answer that mi'echla? Because the moment that it was cohabitation, so he said, that was the manner that the capture used to do with their people, but it's not necessarily manner of rape. The Igrot Moshe in Eben HaEzer, Siman Kavdalet, this is a source of discussion as well as a response called Arkei Noam in Eben HaEzer 43, and you're welcome to read more in my book. Anyway, Amar Rabba or Rava, Dilma lo'i, ad kan lo kama Rabbi Yudacha, ela shelo yeh chote niskar, which means since he raped her, so he should not exempt from paying the fine. Aval ha'atam, ki Rabbanan svir alev. Ina me'ad kan, which means that daughter of Kohen that was raped, so she's no longer can eat truma. Ina me'ad kan lo kama Rabbi Dosa atam, ela bitruma de Rabbanan. Meaning, the Rambam explained in Ilchot Truma, and also the Ravid, he said that the whole idea of receiving Truma, it's only rabbinic, it's not biblical. So he said about Knas, when it's come to a rape and the marital involvement, the Oraita, it's biblical, Kerabanan Svirade. So there is a very heavy diyun in the poskim, a discussion among the early sages, what do you do if you have witnesses that someone raped a na'ara, a maid, that she was shvuya, giyoret, etc., that she passed the age of 3 years and 1 day? Do you impose a fine or not? Because the Torah said, asher yarshi'un elokim. So what does that mean? If someone come before us and he declared that he did something, So they said ולא שמרשיע את עצמו. So it's a דיון בפוסקים, how you hold it. אמר לאביי ותעמד רבי יהודה אחא, שלא יחותן נזכרו, ועתני רבי יהודה אומר שבויה שנשבד הרי בקדושתה, אפילו בת 10 שנים כתובתה 200. Even she was 10 years old, we still hold that is 200. Unlike someone who's already no longer virgin, that it's only 100. ואת המאי שלא יחותן נזכר עיקר, what is that applied? התמנה מדילמה ממן ולא נס ולה. We have compassion upon those misfortunate girls. So we figured out that she received such a reputation, people have started thinking twice before getting married to them. So the rabbis came out with the idea of 200, in a sense to compensate or to give her in the same way as a regular way. But anyway, you see here that a captured one, she still have the din of Be'ula. So the Gemara challenged that. Tosfot here said, the big question is what exactly happened during the time that she was captured. וסבר רבי יהודה בקדושתה קיימה, והתניא, הפודת השבויה יישאנה. Which means the one who released a capture can marry her if he wished to. מעיד בה לא יישאנה. But however, if he come before the rabbinic court and he declare that she is she never have a relation, therefore he cannot marry her. Rabbi Yehuda אומר בן כך ובן כך לא יעשיינה. Rabbi Yehuda said regardless he should not marry her. So he said הגוף הקשה אמרת בודד השבויה יעשיינה, והדר אמרת מעיד בה לא יעשיינה. משום דמעיד בה לא יעשיינה, just because he is part of the testimony he cannot marry her. הלוקה שאחר כך אמר בודד השבויה מעיד בה יעשיינה. So since he released her in order to marry her, he checked very carefully before he released her to make sure that no one raped her during the captivity time. Otherwise, we have the assumption that it may happen that she was raped during the captivity time, and therefore she is prohibited to him, and it means that he wastes his money in vanity because he needs to divorce her since she is prohibited to him. Me'id ba kedei lo yisaena. But, meaning the one who released her just the testimony without paying the expense of release, so the fear is that he is now come to Beit Din and say it just in order to marry her. That's his motivation, not because he have the evidence that that's the truth. מכל מקום קשה לרבי יהודה. In any event, the brayta is difficult according to Rabbi Yehuda, as contrary to the earlier statement, he states that the captive woman does not retain the presumptive status of a virgin. And you see here, earlier he said that she is prohibited to kohen. So he said, Amar Rav Papa Ema, Rabbi Yehuda Omer Ben Kach Ben Kach Yisaena. Rabbi Yehuda said, regardless, he can marry her regardless if the Kohen release her, that he wants to marry her, or he just give a testimony over that. So the Ritva Eden, he said, the same applies regardless if he knew her or even is not he first time see her, he doesn't know anything about her, he just want to marry her, we treated Shvuya Kibtula, like a regular virgin one. רב הונה ברד רב שהוא אומר, another avenue לעולם כדקטני, רב יהודה לדבריהם לרבנן כאמר לו, לדידי, according to my view, בן כך ובן כך יישאנה. So Cohen can marry her because she have חזקת בתולה. אלא להתחו, that you figure out that she was most probably raped and therefore she's considering a בעולה and she's prohibited to Cohen, בן כך ובן כך לא יישאנה מבעלי, so you should say it. So ברבנן בודד השביעה ומעיד בה יישאנה לא שד איני שזדו דה בגדי. Again, the idea is that the person should not impose upon himself the expense of release if he's not clear to him that she is total pure in that sense, or total me'id ba k'day, but if he's only testified for her, lo yisayin Hashem anatan enav ba. Maybe the idea is he put his eyes on her to marry her, and is prepared to lie to facilitate that marriage. So again, if he put the money, he is a ne'eman. So you see here no proof against Rabbi Yochanan, and Rabbi Yehuda hold that Shvuya Kebtula. Rami l'Rav Papa Bar Shmuel l'Rav Yosef, so Tosfot said that all these questions, it's challenging Rabbi Yochanan and not Rava. 37, וסבר רבי יהודה בקדושתה קיימה, which means that she's considering as a virgin, והתניא, הגירות שנתגרה בת אדם, if you have a convert. So we treated the matter of blood originally a different way. The expectation is different, right? So if someone is convert and she see the day period, right? The day after she finalized her process, Rabbi Yehuda omer daya sha'ata. Rabbi Yehuda hold that deeming her impure from the hour that she saw that menstrual flow is sufficient for her. So in general, there is a concept that's called Chumra de Rabbanan, rabbinic stringency. What does that mean? You have a time that a normal situation that women see the dam nida, the blood, and that is a period of time that she is prohibited to her husband, and then is a time of a waiting period, and she go to mikveh. But there is a concept that's called Kotlei Betarechem. The Gemara Nida elaborates that it's a time that she's already have the period, but it's not coming out yet. So the idea is that the rabbi is going a distance in rabbinic stringency up to 24 hours before the time of the appearance. It's affected in a sense that of a touching a consecrated item. So in rabbinic imposition, they go further and they say that this period of 24 hours prior, it's also part of that boundary. So they said it's retroactive act. Rabbi Yossi omer, הרי בכל אנשים הוא מתאמה מעת לעת ומפקידה לפקידה. So you treated her like all the others, and Tosfot have a discussion if you go by that very moment or not, but the idea is you hold it the same as all the other women, Jewish women, as she is therefore transmitting purity retroactively for 24 hours per period from the last time she examined herself. וצריך להמתין שלושה חודשים. דברי רבי יהודה, this is a concept we discuss a lot, that the 3 months period, it's applied to divorcee, it's applied to convert, because we don't know if the baby is part of the previous relationship or current relationship. So רבי יוסי מתיר לה להרס ונעשה מיד. רבי יוסי allow her to go and engage and marry immediately. So by the fact that he require, meaning Rabbi Yehuda require a period of 3 months, you see that he hold that the giyoret is bechazkat be'ula, that the assumption is that she have a former relation in the past, because during the period that she was not part of Jewish faith, she did not watch herself. So Amar Lei, Rabbi Yosef said to Rav Papa Bar Shmuel, גיורת השבויה קרמית, you cannot juxtapose the two in a sense of the דיני 24 שעות, the law of the 24 hours. How do you compare them? The חידה, מרן החידה, ask a question. He said here, גיורת לא מנטרה נפשה. He said the assumption is that a convert does not protect herself from engaging in a sexual relation before conversion. So he said, the Maran Achida said that the truth is, the moment that woman decided to be part of Jewish faith, she's already not in a category of non-Jew in that very moment. Even the process is still in order. Because he called it Nitzotz Kadosh, she have a spark of sanctity from that very moment she make her decisions. If you remember when we studied the sugya of Goses, the someone who's about to die, the story about one of the great rabbi, one of the luminary rabbi, that they have the maid in his house, and she decided to, after many years being a maid, to convert to Judaism. She started her process and she passed. And it was a discussion, can we bury her in a Jewish cemetery like everyone else? And we did. So you see in many halachic discussions, that like the Chida said. Anyway, Shvuya minatra nafsha. So she protecting herself. The truth is, it's a side note, that this is one of the 18 gzerot, the 18 decree, the discussion when it's come to the blood, if dam goya metame beziva, and they decided that it is carry rendering ritual impurity by the final decision. Anyway, v'ram ishvuya shvuya, the tanya agiyoret v'ashvuya v'ashifcha shenivdu v'shenidru v'shenishtacheru, יתרות למנות שלוש שנים ביום אחד, צריכות להמדין שלושה חודשים. Why? Because you have to differentiate between זרע כשר and זרע פסול. דברי רבי יהודה. רבי יוסי מתיר להרס ולנשא מיד. So therefore, the whole idea of waiting period of 3 months is the assumption that the שבויה is בחזקת בתולי. אישתיק. So רבי יוסף display equanimity, right? Acquiesce, he kept his mouth shut. So it's a discussion among some rabbis why there is a way to respond. Anyway, Amar Lei, Midish Mialabea, Amar Lei Ache, Amar Rav Sheshet, Shra'u Ashnivala. So, which means there are witnesses that saw that she was raped by those. Now you ask me what's the applications, there are so many. For example, there is a discussion, heavy, heavy discussion among the rabbis with the adopted children. There is a manner, not by halachic views, that parents keep a secret from the children that they are adopted. Sometimes up to the age 18, up to the bar mitzvah, it's all kind of. We don't hold that. It's incorrect by halacha, because you have many applications such as the law of inheritance, the law of yichud, and many other halachot. Anyway, Iyache maitama de Rabbi Yossi, that allow her to marry immediately. She should wait. אמר רבא, כסבה רב יוסי, אישה מזנה, משמשת במוח, שלא תתעבר. The idea is that women use absorbent cloth, meaning that she tried to avoid, Rashi said, from being pregnant. It's like one of those ancient pregnant control. The truth is that it's a discussion. You see Rashi in 39, that hold that it was afterward, the Yavetz, which appeared that that's the right one, happened before, which is, he said, before everything she used it. The truth is that the Klosenberg Rebbe, may rest in peace, and the Rebbe of Strasbourg and Rav Wozner have a big discussion, many rabbis, how do you treat it by Baalei Tshuva? How do you treat it women that that decided to be religious? You treated her in a sense that she can get married immediately without waiting period of 3 months or not. So it was one of the response of Rabbi Chazkel Rat. They ask a question, how do you do with the Kohen when you have Baal Tshuva Kohen? So he tried to bring the Shuta Mabit. The Mabit discussed in the responsa about Anusei Sfarad, about the Moranos. So the moments they went through that conversion, etc., and they hiding their Judaism, they no longer have the kehuna, the priestly rites that they have. So in that sense, he said that the Mabit hold for the Moranos, after it's all said and done, even they are Jewish, they can marry a divorcee because they don't hold the manner of kehuna. The only he hold that they should, those men should change their last name from Kohen to something else to avoid lazut sfatayim, to avoid people saying, look, this is a Kohen, he married to a divorcee. The truth is nowadays you see a non-Jews by the name of Kohen. Anyway, Bishlama giyoret kevan dedata la'aguriye mitnatra nafsha. Since the convert she intends to convert to Judaism, she will protect herself, she's watching. Shvuyana medroeda echa mamtula. She doesn't know what's going to happen, so she used that avoidance of pregnancy method. Shifchana medeshama mipi mara ela yotza b'shen ve'ayin. As the Torah said, the Canaanite maid or Canaanite servant that she lost her eye, she lost her teeth, etc. So the Torah said in the book of Exodus, chapter 21, that she is getting free. Ma'i kalemeima. וכי תימך כל ממילא לא אמר רבי יוסי, הרי אנוסה ומפותה דמימילא ותניה. הנוסר מפותץ לחוק להמתין שלושה חודשים לרבי יהודה. Right? Those rape or seduced need to wait 3 months. רבי יוסי מתיר לנסה מיד. Allowed to do it immediately. So it means Rabbi Yossi hold more leniency even in a situation that she will not be able to protect herself from being pregnant because it was unpredictable cohabitation. למה רבה, כסבר רבי יוסי, אישה מזנה מתהפכת כדי שלא תתעבר, which means that she does is that way of turning around in order to protect her from being pregnant. ואידך, it's a simple way to avoid pregnancy. חיישין אנשי מלא נהפכה יפה. So maybe she didn't do it right and she got pregnant anyway. So there are some rishonim that say that the teirutz, that the response to all the situations. So here the completion of the Mishnah, they said anyone who impose execution so is free for monetary payment. Shenemar, as we said, ולא יעשון אנוש יענש. We said if two men quarrel, remember, and a woman, in, the wife of one of them interfere, so we said that if she passed, he doesn't, we don't impose any monetary payment. והם מאחה נפקה, מאתם נפקה, רישעתו, משום רישה אחת אתה מחייבו, ואתה מחייבו משום שתי רישיות. So why you need two פסוקים? So the Gemara said, חדה במיטה וממון, וחדה במלכות וממון. So that's the idea of Kimle b'derabanei. You have here the idea that you have malkot, you have the flags, and no money. הוא צריך, יש מהם את הממון משום דלק היבוד נשמה. אבל מלכות, ממון, ודלק היבוד נשמה הם עדו. You have to differentiate between the time that the person loses life versus if it's flags. It's two different things. ויש מהם את הממון משום דלק חמיר איסורי. מיטה וממון דלק חמיר איסורי הם עדו צריך. So you need it more פסוקים. So the רב חיים מבריסק have a concept here that it's called Tzvei Dinim. The two different Dinim. Why? Because the Torah said when it's come to death, that is Chamur, that it's severe punishment, versus the Matai Mane, that it's monetary payment, that is Kal, versus when you have in Malkot and Mamon, flags and money, that's the Torah said Kederish Ato. So the truth is, he tried to say, how do you juxtapose the two? It's two different manners, which means, when you have death, death involves everything. Death is death. There's nothing more severe than death. Versus when you talk about flags, so flags, it's the idea, it's one punishment and not two punishment. So Rav Shach, in Achiezer, many others respond to what Briske Rav said, Rav Chaim Briske, this is the idea of Tzrichuta. Why you need Tzrichuta? You have Nafkamina, if a person have a damage from him, if you impose a punishment upon the other one or not. Because if you have such a severe punishment, that included. They have a lot of applications. For example, if someone created damage that the person's family lost the main income. And since you impose one severe punishment and it's still a state involved, how you treat it. So in general, that's the discussion of the Briske Rav. Will that Rabbi Meir Damar, Lokeo Mishalem Tartei Lamali, why you need two pesukim? Chada b'mita u'mamon. So the moment that he executed is no money involved. 37b, v'chada b'mita u'malkut. So the other pasuk, which is v'hipilo ha-shofet v'ikau lefanav g'day rishato. This is the pasuk that tells us the punishment of malkut. He teaches us that that applies in a sense that you have two severe punishments, but for sure nothing more severe than the death penalty. So according to Rabbi Meir, this line teaches us that if someone committed double crime, or he did a crime that involved two transgressions, one deserved death and one deserved malkot, so we go by rish'ah achat, only one wicked act, which is the death penalty override kimle bederaba minei, and not the malkot, the flags, utzricha. We need the two pesukim. So, as a side note, the Mishmar Levi tried to say that you have application here in a case, for example, when Chag HaShavuot, when the festival of Shavuot occurred on Shabbat. So think about it. If someone violated the festival while the festival occurred on Shabbat, you have double. So you have the Mavet and you have the Malkot. So therefore, he said that since you have the severe punishment, it's already exempt the Malkot, the least punishment. Anyway, Diyash minan mitar mamot mishum dechada begufei vechada bemamonei lo avdina. As we said, you cannot go that way, which is basically you give double punishment for one transgressions. Aval b'mitah v'malkot de'ite v'iti begufei. That both of them applies to his body. Why? Because death is in his body, flags in his body. Eima mitah arichtai. You may think that the receiving malkot together with death, it's considering like a one long extended death, and v'na'avid bei, and we impose upon him both. V'i'ash me'inan mitah u'malkot. Detarte begufei lo avdinan, because you don't impose upon a person's body both. Aval mitah u'mamon dechada begufei vechada be'mamonei, since, as we said, one is in body, one is in money. Eimanavid bei. We may say that we impose upon him the two punishments. Richa. So we need two pesukim. Now listen. Trace the scenario. Someone committed the crime of killing. God forbid. The family of the criminal goes to the family of the victim and said, look, we know that it's already verdict in order. The Bet Din decided, hypothetically speaking, to execute that person. Here is $1 million, right? And let him off the hook. So the Torah said here, ולא תיקחו חופר לנפש רוצח. The Torah said in Book of Numbers, chapter 35, verse 31, You should not take no ransom for the life of a murderer who is guilty of death, which means that one does not take payment from a person sentenced to death. Lamali. Why you need the two psukim? What we mentioned earlier, we have a pasuk in Shmot, Kaf Aleph, in Exodus 21, verse 22, ולא יעשו לנו שיענש, if two men quarrel and it's involved with tragedy, the pregnant woman passed, he has the severe punishment of death. So why do you need two pesukim to teach you this concept of death penalty? The Shita Mekubetzet explained here on Rashi that the big quandary in the other one is how exactly you treated the dmei ubarim, the money compensation for the miscarriage of the babies. But anyway, since we have two different psukim that teach us the same, why? So the Gemara said, no. The Amar HaChamana, the Torah, said, lo tishkol mamonei zevet itflemi iktala. You cannot take this money and exempt him from death. That the murderer cannot exempt himself from death by paying this money. Now, in a very similar way, the Gemara asked, "Lo tikhu kofer nanus elir miklato." We have in the book of Bamidbar, book of number chapter 35, a situation of a rescue city. You remember that? If someone committed a crime, unintentional crime, and the blood, meaning the family members, Goel Adam, of the victim, want to chase the person to pay him back, so they build a rescue city so he can run and be rescued. So the question is, Lamali, why do you need this pasuk? Since we already said in the term when you have two men quarrel and the pregnant wife interfere, and if it's a tragedy, he have that punishment. We derive for that that in a case of murderer, the payment is unacceptable. So this pasuk appears superfluous. So the Gemara responded and said, "The Amar Achmana lo tishkol mamone minei utfertei min galut." The Gemara said, "You know what? That the Torah, they use the word Rachmana because it's a mercy. The Torah is a merciful one. They said, do not take money from him and exempt him from exile. Meaning, you should not take money and think that this fellow can get away of this." Imagine the family goes to the whoever is in charge and said, here is the money, let him off the roof, cannot go to exile. So it's not kimle bedraba minei, it's a different story. The Or Sameach have a discussion over the subject of galut. What is galut? What is the idea of exile? So he said, his big dilemma is galut, the exile. It's a punishment for him or rescue for the killer, unintentional killer. If you tell me it's a punishment, think about the fellow. Or let's say if you said it's a rescue, think about the fellow that killed a slave. The slave, no one, unintentional. The slave, the deceased, is no one to pay back. So what do you need the rescue for? So you have to say that it's solely punishment. The whole institution of going to Ir Miklat, to the rescue city, it's a punishment. It's not a matter of city of rescue by definition, because there are many situations that can be no issue of Goel Adam, no issue of rescue. That's the Or Sameach. Anyway, what you see here, Utrei Krai Lamali, why we need a two psukim that a murderer cannot exempt himself from both? Chad b'shogeg v'chad b'mezid. One, it was a murderer intentionally. One is unintentionally, v'tzricha. Diyash minan mezid mishum dechamir yisurei. Because intentional, that it's a heavy punishment. Aval shugeg lo chamir yisurei, eima lo. Viyash minan shugeg mishum deleika ibu neshama. Aval mezid yika ibu neshama, eima lo tzricha. So therefore you need the two psukim. Now, the Gemara, after they bring the two psukim that teaches us that you cannot take a kofer, you cannot take a compensation, any money, in order to exempt the fellow from its punishment. So the Gemara asks a question. We said in the book of Bamidbar, book of Numbers, chapter 35, ולארץ לא יחופר לדם אשר שופח בה, כי אם בדם שופחו. The Torah tells us that no expiation can be made for the land for the blood that is shed therein, but by the blood of him that shed it, which also indicates that he cannot be exempted by money. So the question is, Lamali, why you need another pasuk to teach us that we cannot absolve himself from death penalty by means of payment? We already learned from the word Lo tikach kofer nefesh rotzeach. Mibayel elich detanya. Now we're going to a new subject, which is not so new, but it's a subject that involved with a egla arufa. Nichdetanya minayin sheim nitarfa egla v'achar kach nimtza horeg minayin shen potrim oto. So the Torah said in Deuteronomy chapter 21, they live in Eretz Yisrael, they found the crops in a proximity of a city, and is unknown who murdered him. So the Torah commanded that the elders of the city, meaning the people who was the leaders, they need to measure in the elders of the city that it's closest to the body, they need to take this ritual, they need to take a calf that never work be done on the calf, and they have to take it to a hard river that never be used, and then they need to beheaded the head of the calf. And then, the most important, they make a declaration that our hands not involved in this crime. Now, the truth is, the moment you did it, it's over, right? Now, how about if the murderer, the killer, was found after they did all this ritual? שנאמר ולארץ לא יכופר לאדם אשר שופח בה. So the great Gaon, Rabbi Natan Lubart, you have here all this malach, what exactly happened in general? If someone did not get punishment here or did get punishment here. In general, he said that punishment that you don't see here, it's Hashem's punishment, which means there's a certain category, Bidei Shamayim, that we don't know. So if, for example, Bet Din said that he's exempt, Deveg La'ufa, and then you see the Midin Torah is Chayav, he is obligated. So here was the Pasuk, they said, Ve'ata teva'er hadam anaki mikirbecha. They said that you, and so shall you put away the innocent blood from your midst. So appears to be teaching the very same halacha, that the murderer must be executed. So they said, Lamali, why you need the pasuk? Because we learn already, v'la'aretz lo yichupar l'adam asher shupach ba'kim b'dam shofcho. You see a clear pasuk. So Reb Chaim Kanievsky wrote a special book just on the subject of Egla Arufa, and he discussed this matter that after you did the ritual of Egla Arufa, all of a sudden the killer was found. So you have a discussion, why is exempt? Rabbi Yashiv said that all of that applies if it was intentional, mezid, and therefore he needs to have a galut. The purpose of that pasuk is as follows. How do you know that those who deserve penalty by saif, meaning by sword, murderer, their execution is administered from the neck and nowhere else? Talmud lomar ואתה תבאר אדם הנקים מקרבך הוגשו כל שופכי דמים לגלר ופמל אלן מן הצוואר אף שופכי דמים מן הצוואר. We all compare to the beheaded calf brought to the unsolved matter. The same way all E, so the Gemara said, if that's the case, E מל אלן בקופיץ ומול עורף, אף כאן בקופיץ ומול עורף. The same that there, in the case of beheaded calf, beheaded is a cleaver, and it was nap of the neck. Here's two, the court executes murderers with the cleaver and the nap of the neck. Now, so the Gemara said, if you compare the dinim of lerotzeach to egla arufa, malalan bekupitzu mimul oref, afkan bekupitzu mimul oref, that both of them you use what? The cleaver and the nape of the neck. So you see here, why you don't do it straight to his face? I mean to say, the way that they kill them is straight to the face and not from the neck. אמר רב נחמן אמר רבא ברבוע אמר קרא ואהבת לרעך כמוך בכל לא מיתה יפה. So the idea of love thy neighbor as thyself, it means even it's come to that one, do not make it, choose for him the agreeable day, death. If it is prohibited to abuse a guilty person while executing him and chopping off his head with a cleaver as his unnecessary death. The murderer is beheaded from the neck, no, from a cleaver and not by other method employed in beheading the calf. So if you remember, we study Tractate Bava Metzia, page 62b. It's the sugya of Ben Ptura and Rabbi Akiva. Two people, Shnai Malchim, two people walk in a desert, and it's only one jar of water. So Ben Ptura said, love thy neighbor as thyself, they let them share. And Rabbi Akiva said, no. V'che achicha imach, you life take precedent before you fellow. So the Shita Mekubetzet derived from that, that when it's come to re'acha, ve'avta le're'acha, love thy neighbor as thyself, that's applied to mitzvot, not to avirot. The reality is that a fellow Jew is a fellow Jew, he remained there. But if you remember when we studied Tanya, right? So in Tanya they said that if the Rasha, if the person who used to be a wicked, now is not active, is not yugid, so we have the mitzvah to love him and to help him. We have this framework. So when it's come here to punishment, think that it's you, and think in a way that you chooses from the least pain, from the least disrespect, etc., etc. So the same way you treated another fellow. That's the framework of B'cholo Mitayafa.
Shuloim, Malachai, Shuloim, Malachai.